Well, you're welcome to yet another wonderful edition of this program on this YouTube channel that God has used to bless us so much. Well, we are back this hour, and the man of God, whom Jesus Christ appeared to, is live on the program this morning. And together we're going to be sharing a lot of experience, the experience of having a one-on-one encounter with Christ, the resolution of that encounter, and what has been unfolding in the ministry, and what is the message of God to the church, and to you, and to myself, and to everybody in the body of Christ. There are a lot and lot of things happening in the body of Christ today, and these are things that actually bothers God. But God has sent his servant in this end time to warn the church, to warn you watching this program, and to let us know the reality of both heaven and on hell. I have on set with me the man that God has been using all over the world, a man to whom Jesus Christ appeared and gave a mandate to sanitize the church. And you are so lucky to be on the program this morning. Sir, you're welcome on the program this hour.
God bless you.
Thank you. To start with, I want us to start from the scrap. The experience of meeting Jesus live. Can we just have a recap of that, sir?
Like a person, as a person who God granted grace to meet Jesus Christ one-on-one, it has been my prayer that more people will be able to have such an encounter, because sometimes you can't be able to explain it. But God knows the way he does his thing, the way he works. I wasn't praying, I wasn't asking for it when Jesus Christ suddenly appeared, you know, to me one-on-one. And when you hear some of our slogans that Christianity without encounter is counterfeit. You know, when people have not encountered Jesus Christ, they can't be Christians. It's an encounter with Jesus Christ in any way. Whether in the way he appeared to me one-on-one, which biblically we are all over the place, when he resurrected, he was appearing to his disciples for 40 days. You know, and up till today, in fact, if you hear what the appearances of Jesus is doing in places like Saudi Arabia, these Muslim countries, it's amazing. And of course, encountering Christ can be in different ways. You can encounter him through revelation, through the word, and so forth and so on. But the truth remains that if you have not encountered Christ, you are not yet a Christian. Because you are talking,
it's not everybody that has that opportunity of having that experience that you had.
No, not in the dimension that I had. You see, Jesus Christ, Christianity is not a religion. Christianity has to do with a person. And if you don't have personal encounter, personal contact with that person, you are not a Christian yet. Because it's a person. If it's religion, the dogmas, you know, and the rest could be where you circle.
Of course.
But Christianity is based on the encounter with the person of Jesus Christ, in whichever way.
Deeper revelation, sir.
Deeper revelation, one-on-one encounter, physical, whichever way. There has to be an encounter. And that is why today we have church members, but not Christians. Because they have not encountered Christ.
That makes a difference.
And if our pulpits understand what I'm saying, we will begin to produce Christians. When people come to understand that going to church doesn't have any meaning, but encountering Christ. So if you come to the gathering is unto him. So if he's not there, you don't have business there.
But there is this popular saying by a lot of Christians that the Bible says that we should not forsake the assemblies of one another. And to them, just going to church is all that God
has. That is not what that scripture is saying. It says we should not forsake the assembling of one another. One another. People of the same mind. As we see the day approaching. They don't add that one. Which day is that?
The coming of the Lord.
But that one is completely cut off. What you hear them say is you should not forsake the assembling of, then they turn the church to club. If that aspect is added as the day, as we see the day approaching, in other words, as we live as if Jesus will come today, if that is the approach of the church, this mess that we are seeing today all over the world in the churches won't be there.
It's truly a mess. It's truly a mess.
It will never be there. Because if you a Christian is meant to live as if Jesus is coming today. So if the so-called gathering is not towards that, it's not towards Jesus, it's not towards the urgency of his coming, that is not the church of Jesus Christ.
So how was that experience like? Because each time when I think about it, I begin to wonder, having a one-on-one encounter with Christ, how was it like? Not very many people have that opportunity.
It did happen once, but let me just share a few of them. Like, I was in the room. The door was locked. I wasn't thinking of Jesus Christ.
Were you a believer then, sir?
I was in a Christian family. I was born in a Christian family.
Like many people today.
You know, that just like most of us. But what happens is that God knows us. He said to Jeremiah, before I formed your mother's womb, I knew you. And I ordained you. Jeremiah didn't even know why he was on earth. But God knew. He knew everything about every one of us. So he knew me. He knew what he ordained to do with me. Just like Paul said, that from his mother's womb, before he was, you know, the grace of God located him to do what he did. Now, I was sitting down, and I'm speaking frankly to the glory of God. I wasn't asking for Jesus. I wasn't thinking of him. I wasn't looking for him. The door was closed. I was in the room sitting down, and he suddenly appeared. And the message he gave is the exact thing that is going on today.
Can you let us into that, sir?
Jesus, as he appeared, he said, the devil will tempt you in my form. Be careful. And as soon as he finished saying that, he turned into identical to, which you cannot differentiate. Only by the Holy Spirit can you discern and know that this is him and this is not him, despite that two of them resemble.
Is that not a reflection of what is happening in the church today?
Completely, 100% plus. And I'm saying this before God who created heaven and earth. I am saying this, why I say before God who created heaven and earth, so that those who have ear will know that this is not one of those so-called divine revelations or claims. No. Not at all. Jesus Christ, he said the devil. So those who don't know that there is devil should hear this. We tempt you in my form. Be careful.
And that is already happening now.
Completely. When I look at what is happening, and look at what happened in that encounter with Jesus Christ, I saw how true Jesus is. How Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. How real everything about him is. This is what is playing out all over the places. Many, not some, of the churches you see today are worshiping the other Jesus.
That Jesus. It's unfortunate.
It's very unfortunate, and it is dangerous. And like I said, only discernment of the Holy Spirit. And this same Holy Spirit has been driven away from many churches. And another spirit is operating. So how will they be able? And many of the Christians today don't understand what discernment is. And discernment is called the compulsory gift. That is what discernment is called. Every believer that has the Holy Spirit is compulsorily meant to have discernment. Because we are in the time when the devil has transformed himself into angel of light. And his ministers into ministers of righteousness. How do you now be able to know if you don't have discernment of the Holy Spirit? Now, this is one of the things that the five foolish virgins suffered. They had oil. It got finished. Their relationship with the Holy Spirit was quenched. There was no flow. The extra oil. Any Christian, any believer that is not flowing in the Holy Spirit, allowing the Holy Spirit to flow, is in danger. Because you cannot be smarter than the devil. Apart from that, without the Holy Spirit, you are not sealed for rapture. Without the Holy Spirit, you can't be able to serve God. Without the Holy Spirit, that's why Jesus told them not to leave, not to go to leave Jerusalem until he comes. Without the Holy Spirit, there's nothing anybody can do. Jesus Christ could not do anything without the Holy Spirit. That same Holy Spirit is being grieved out of the church. So the Holy Spirit, through which you'll be able to know that this man you think is a man of God, because the time we are in now is time of deception. And deception, you can't be deceived except what you are being deceived would look like it. It is not it, but it looks like it. If I open my mouth to expose some big ministers, some pastors all over the world who are now serving this other Jesus, it will be as if they will say you are condemning, you are judging.
We have so much, especially when it gets to the level where we need to talk about 99%, one of his book. Well, if you have not read 99% of Men of God on Their Way to Hellfire, you need to have a copy of that book. I'm sure if you read that book, you have a better understanding of what the witness is saying. So now let's come to your ministry. At the initial stage, towards the closing time, when you need to close down, when God asked to close down the church, miracles were everywhere. People were, because I was one of those people that actually, you know, attended some of those programs. Miracles everywhere. People believed that people were coming down. Ikeja then was just like a beehive of activity every day when there was a program. Then all of a sudden, God asks you to close down the church. Can you just give us an insight into all this?
That was an acid test. You are running a church.
A very buoyant church.
Very powerful. People come, cars all over the place. People hang on their cars. People carry chairs, hire chair by themselves from outside the country everywhere. And you, when you hear miracles, unbelievable things, unimaginable power demonstration, without effort, and then all of a sudden you are asked to close it.
I wonder how you managed that situation.
I didn't obey. I was like, what is going on? Am I sure he's the one talking? I know he's the one, but
I imagine.
He said, close down the church, go and sanitize my church. How do I sanitize your church? Where do I start? So I was busy doing what I was doing. And miracles were still happening.
I'm sure one of the questions that will come to your mind, where am I to do that? Where you have big generals, big bishops all over the world.
And where do I start? So it happened that one day, after a period of time, I was disturbed. People were enjoying miracles, but I was disturbed. I knew I wasn't serving in obedience. I was really disturbed. And Jesus stopped appearing to me. Then one day, he appeared. When I saw him, I was so happy.
After a long time.
So I was approaching him with joy. And he brought out Cain and flogged me 3 times. And when he saw the way I felt when he flogged me, because I said to him, I didn't know he would flog me. He felt it so much. Jesus is so loving. And he embraced me. And he said something I will never forget. He said, "You're my driver. But I don't like the speed you're going with." That interpretation, if I carry so it on, deep. It so is deep. Very deep.
It's so deep.
We are Jesus' driver. He won't get to anywhere without us. That is why it's very painful. The urgency, the speed, the direction we are going is so important because he is depending on us. We are his legs. Now, I was busy pleasing men, enjoying miracles, signs and wonders.
Just like a whole lot of men of God.
It is all over. My dear, you will handpick ministers that are still in obedience. And the what some of us don't know, and I'm not saying this to judge or condemn anybody because I have made the same mistake. What many of us don't know that without submission, you will never fulfill your mission.
Without submission,
you can't fulfill your mission. Obedience is key.
Total obedience.
Total, no partial. Total obedience. Jesus came to this earth, obeyed his Father to the letter, even unto death. But today, we are doing it as if we and Jesus are mates. He will ask you to do something, you do it the way you like, or even not do. You will read the Bible, read his word, choose the ones you like. What we are doing is not criticism, it's not judgment, it's not condemnation. We are doing the work of a watchman. We are doing, I'm doing the work of a witness who witnessed, who saw, and who is relaying what he has seen and what he has heard
to the whole world.
To the whole world. Jesus told me that no church could accommodate his congregation. So it's not, that's why I don't practice section. You see, today there is gospel of two extremes. There are those who say they are holiness. Now, the other ones say they are, I don't know whether to call them Pentecostal or whatever to call them. You see them going to the extremes. This, some of these ones that say, not all of them, some of these ones that say they are holiness, don't know they have entered into religious bondage. Because they are no more pursuing Christ, but pursuing dogmas. Pursuing do's and don'ts. Some of which are good.
Man-made.
But the way they are going about it, not chasing after Christ, not Christ-likeness, has made them deviate without knowing.
These are people that see other Christians as
they see, they don't know that self-righteousness is unrighteousness.
It's a sin on its own.
Hell is the end of self-righteousness. They don't know when they have denied the cross, where Jesus said it is finished, and have followed religion of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And then the other ones on the other side say hyper grace. They take they preach love of God and forget the judgment of God. And so they take things to the extremes
on both sides
rather than balancing it on Christ and his cross.
In fact, I know of some ministries that their members believe that once you are not a member of that ministry, you are not making heaven.
Some tell their members that it's only them that will go to heaven. Can you imagine such a place? It's a cult. It's a deceiving center.
Holier than thou.
It is very wrong. It is, anywhere you go, they tell you such thing. If you don't run for your life, you have missed it. Because it's a manipulation, it's witchcraft. It is a gimmick to hold you in bondage. You cannot, you are not Jesus who qualifies those who will go to heaven and those who will not go to heaven. Who would tell, who have told you that the thief on the cross
make heaven?
Will make heaven.
He was the first candidate there.
the man was a special Christian. The only believer that was crucified with Jesus on the same spot. Who never did one righteous thing.
He never even confessed his sins.
No. I was telling some group of pastors the other time that man was the greatest preacher, the best evangelist, because he evangelized on the cross.
At the most difficult place.
On the cross. And they were like, I said, yes. On the cross was where he witnessed Jesus. So he is special. So we people, you see what the devil is doing? The devil has come to turn the other side of the Pentecostal to something else. Now, some people have seen that there are things wrong with what is going on. Naked women showing their breasts, showing everything in the church, and they say it doesn't matter.
And the pastor, but the pastor does not bother himself
about it. Not at all. You know, a pastor was telling me what happened. They invited a pastor to their church to preach. One Marine girl was sitting at the front with the legs open, with the breast and everything. And when the pastor entered, important program, he shouted that today the blind will walk.
In the midst of danger.
And the lame will see. He didn't know what he was saying again. He said the blind. They said today blind will walk.
The blind will walk.
And the lame will see.
That's a power of manipulation.
The marine girl has captured him.
It happens everywhere now.
You see, so the devil has seen that there is a lot of rascality in the Pentecostal we have today. And then some people say, oh, let us move to holiness. Now, some of them are taking it to another religion.
So how do we balance this? How do we balance?
My dear, Jesus Christ and Him crucified is the gospel. Once you take it away from Jesus, it is no more the gospel. Both of them are not focusing on Jesus and his cross. Unless it is Jesus, we don't need more than Jesus. If it is not Jesus, it's not the message.
It's not the message.
It's not the gospel. Whether you are naked or whether you wear a gown or you are whatever, if Jesus
is not at the center,
it's not at the center, it's not the message. It's not the gospel. And this is the correction that I am trying to bring between both.
The two extreme ends.
The two extreme ends. So, because it is dangerous. And the devil is the one operating it. Can you imagine a pastor telling the members that they should not fast? That when they slept throughout the night and woke up in the morning, that is called breakfast in the morning, so that they have fasted.
What they were saying.
I didn't believe it until a minister sent it to me, and I said, so you mean this person is well? So he's saying that Jesus didn't fast.
And ironically, the people will believe him.
That is the dangerous thing going on right now. The people you see today going to church, many of them don't read their Bibles anymore.
Pastor said.
They wait for Papa. Said. They wait for Mama. They wait for what the pastor. Look at the Christians in Acts of the Apostles. When Paul finished, they go to check to be sure that this is true.
Now, can it now be said that this is a device of the devil?
It is the devil. It's his manipulation. It's his deception. People don't read Bible. Some people don't even go to church with their Bible anymore. They go with phone.
It's everywhere.
So you see the extent of decay.
It's terrible.
That is going on.
It's terrible. So we can go on and on, but this is just the beginning. Yeah. And in this series, we are going to hear so much exposition about what is going on, the rot in the church. The situation calls for so much of attention. And that is exactly what we are trying to do on this program. The exposition of the situation of the church. What is God telling you? What is God telling me? What is the message of God to the church? Is it good enough for you to just go to church? Or there are a lot of other information that God would like you to have about the position and the condition and the situation of the church today. If you are a victim, you need to listen. If you have somebody somewhere who is a victim, you must watch this. Every time, listen and watch this program. Because there will be lot and lot of things that will be revealed by this servant of God that has that rare opportunity of meeting one-on-one with Christ. What is the experience like? Since then till now, what is God saying about the church? What is God saying about your pastor? What is God saying about you? Next time out, we'll still be back with more information from the man that God actually allowed or gave the grace to see Jesus Christ live. And he's a witness. And that is why you can't afford to miss this program next time out. Zadi, I want to thank you for this particular episode. Yes. And very soon you'll see us again on another wonderful edition. Keep watching this program. God bless you.